call it a tale of two cities, because generally we see them as being belonging to very different paradigms. So innovation is seen as new, as progress, and tradition is seen as old and conservation, preservation kind of thing. I'm using the case of Handloom, and that is a technology that has survived for more than 2000 years. So without innovation, it would not have survived. But at the same time, it's not something that is associated with innovation. Is more associated with tradition. So I will try and see how within Handloom these two interact, how they relate to each other. And that's going to be my presentation today. I'll quickly walk through what I'm going to talk about. I'm using innovation framework of the economist called Sean Peter, and he has three fairly broad areas in which innovations take place, and he calls them, it's usually product, and then user innovation, and then it's process innovation. So I'll talk a little bit about that in my mind. But this framework very clearly comes to us in Handloom from outside. So I spent a little bit of time looking at what does it mean empirically in our culture. And there it seemed a little more appropriate to talk about creativity rather than innovation. So that was the first shift, you know, in terms of creativity. And the second step, which happened totally through serendipity, was not a planned rational step of talking about innovation, is that because I happened to be doing a project in music at that time when we were when I was doing this. I found there a vocabulary for talking about innovation, which I explored to see if it might work for us to understand innovation in our culture. So I looked at the vocabulary of creativity in Dramatic music and then tried to relate it back to creativity in science. Because that is what we are actually looking at, technological innovation. And then trying to relate innovation in tradition. Why innovation? Because innovation is seen as a driver for growth. And it is also seen as, I look at it as a way to draw investment into Handloom. If we can explicate innovation, then it is possible to show that there is a future and prospects for Handloom. So I look at innovation and Handloom. I use Schumpeter because the framework has two important elements. One is that he talks about innovation in relation to society, in relation to market, and that's an important shift. And the second shift is that he's not looking at innovation as being necessarily direction towards progress. He doesn't see it as being linear. He sees innovation processes as being jumpy, as being bridges. So that's a framework that I found useful. Even within that framework, rather than talking about creative destruction, which is one of his core ideas, he also talks about innovation as new ways of combining existing resources. So that is the kind of frame I'm using within the product user analysis. So when I first met one of my supervisors, it's not called Luke Box, who has worked in development extensively, and I explained to him that it's possible to make a case for Handloom as technology. And that it is adaptive, and it has survived for a lot of through many crises. And that I would write about the crises that it has survived. He actually threw me a challenge. He said, if really Handloom is innovative and it is adaptive, then show me a crisis that it's facing right now, and show me the response, the adaptive, creative response that it is exhibiting right now. Go find it. And if you are able to make the case with that, then that will convince me better than any past. So at that point, there was a huge crisis in yarn. Prices were fluctuating, and in fact, I think during that period, 2008-09, it doubled, the price of yarn almost doubled. So as I was going through my field work, I kept looking for what kind of responses might have come to that kind of crisis. So what is it that weavers were doing themselves in response to this crisis? And what I expected was that since yarn price had gone up and it squeezed the labor cost, I thought I would find weavers actually forced to do be more productive. So they would either shift to more jacquard, things like that, which produced more fabric, so that the decrease in labor could be compensated by more work, by more productivity. This is what I expected to see actually. But in a lot of places, in many, many of the villages, the more entrepreneurial weavers were just one or two in each place, were actually picking up and going back to a technique that was very old, which is the Jamdani technique, which is a very, very labor intensive technique. So rather than innovating towards productivity, they were actually slowing down as a response to the yarn price. And it took me a while to recognize that as a response to the yarn price crisis. But when I thought about it, it started making sense, because the price of the yarn increases, the amount of money that you put into the yarn goes up, then you would rather put more labor into it than invest more and more capital in more and more yarn. So it made sense for them to actually slow down and take a more labor intensive. But it was an innovation in the backward direction, because it was not seen as more fast, more efficient, more productive kind of technology. So it is a kind of a backward innovation. Looking at it in terms of product innovation, this was the kind of product they were making, which was fairly plain. And they moved to this technique, and you can see the patterns on the fabric. Those are actually made by hand. So as you weave, you stop every time you draw the shuttle and you insert different spindles into the yarn. It's almost like embroidering on the fabric. So it is very, very slow. But because you're customizing it to that effect, to that extent, you can really do very, very elaborate kind of designs. And this is the Jamdani technique, and this is the product that they're making. And they were picking up this product and they were able to do it. Now, the question was, does this count as innovation? If they're just going back to something that they used to do, which was older, does it count as innovation? And it counts as product innovation for one reason, that the weavers who were actually doing it were not weavers who already knew this technique. They were learning it as a new technique. So to that extent, it could have been seen as something new. So that was a case I made for product innovation. And the next category that I used was of market innovation. So you can't, if you only innovate in product, that's not the reason why Jamdani existed. They also innovated in the market. How they had innovated in the market was quite interesting. We had this was done while I was in Dastkar, and then came on this future with me, and you show that with a lot of the Jamdani so there was this village where we went to the dye house. So this dyer was actually also willing to give out yarn for the years. Now that's not something you give a yarn trader, but in this case the dyer was dyeing bits of yarn and giving it to the, and there was an auto rickshaw driver who during the day would ply the auto, and during the evening would sit with his wife and weave this sari. Now that was a little unusual, because usually weavers don't invest in their own yarn. Usually it's a yarn trader who gives the, they don't have capital. But because this fellow was already doing a day job, he was able to afford this. And what he would do once he made the sari was that he had, so I asked him, okay, fine, you make it, how do you sell it? Because you're only making one sari a month, and you have to have 20 saris if you want to sell. So he said, there are aunties and ladies in Hyderabad and all those cities, and they actually buy this. So basically what he had was a list of phone numbers on his mobile, and he used the mobile, which is a new technology, to reach these aunties and ladies, and he would go to their house and he would collect saris from other weavers, go and sell and come back. So he had actually shifted away from the retail model. He was selling directly in a much older style, but he was doing it using the mobile phone. So this was a kind of a, so I presented this as a kind of a market innovation, that we were able to grow, to reach new markets to produce new products. And in order to make this argument, I talked about not just the technology that was in the loom, that is the loom, but the socio-technical ensemble, that handloom actually consists of dyers, warpers, sizers, weavers, traders, designers, retailers, customers, and all these people together actually form what we call the handloom ensemble. It's not just the loom. Look at this. This is basically a picture of all the technologies in the same house. At the very corner is the loom. Then you have a jacquard punching machine, you have the computer, and you have the programmer working on his mobile phone, actually. So all those technologies, but they have to relate to each other. So they have to be social institutions where through which these different technologies actually talk to each other, these people talk together. And each of these people has their own set of technologies. So for instance, I was able to make the case of the weaver trader was able to use the mobile phone. And therefore it entered the social technical ensemble, and then that's how it becomes a technological innovation. And the reason that it is like this is because otherwise the question that comes to you is the loom is static, the loom doesn't change. So how can you say that there is innovation? So that question still remains. So is it true that the loom doesn't change? Is it true that the loom is static? Is it true that there is no upgradation of the loom itself? So that is the question with which I went into the next You've seen this picture before. This is the picture of the Jamdani product. Now this is a picture from the 1830s from the Victoria Albert Museum. It's the same technique. You can see even the motif looks quite similar. But if you pay close attention to that, you will see that that motif looks a little pixelated. Can you see it? There's some jagged edges.
No uniform.
It doesn't look as smooth as this. So I investigated that a little bit and found actually these patterns are being made by the computer. There are computer designers who are making these things. And now computerization is in some sense seen like mechanization, taking away skill from the weaver. So I was quite judgmental when I met this computer programmer, because I said, you are imposing your pixelated picture onto the weaver, and instead of making this very beautiful product, what to my eyes was a very beautiful product, he is making this pixelated thing. In fact, if you see the other shape, it's a little crude. It's drawn actually with the mouse, the leaf. But the paisley is a traditional. So I kept trying to tell him, why don't you smooth out the resolution on your screen? And he kept telling me, you don't understand what is happening. I can't do it here, it has to be done on the loom. But I kept telling him that what is here is on the loom, so you can do it. To smooth it out, he will make that 9%. In the end, what it turned out is that when he realized when the weaver and the programmer sat together, is that the weaver told him, I want 3 turns and 100 bends. So basically, he was telling him, I want a mango motif. So he was actually specifying the labor he was willing to put in. And based on that, the computer programmer was coming up with a resolution. So as soon as it reached the point at which the labor would match the remuneration, the weaver would say, yes, this is the design I will have. And the computer programmer would make that design on the graph and give it to him. So rather than the computer programmer imposing his program onto the weaver, the weaver was using the digital nature of the computer software, which is actually the same digitally. The warp and weft acted exactly the same way. And so he was using that technology too. So it became very clear that the polarized idea of one technology being hierarchically over the other might not always be operating. So then I tried to see where else, how else the computer was being used. And they also used it to generate these graphs in order to make the repeats in the design. I won't go into all of that, most of you know this stuff. didn't know much about that. But basically, in order to create a repeat, you have to pick up threads that repeat. So if the motor has to repeat, in each part it has to repeat, you have to pick up that thread and pass the spindle under it. So if you want to make it easy, you pick up all the threads at one go and pass the spindles, it's easier. So then that goes from the quadrant vectors X and Y axis, it goes into the Z axis. You may create a third set of threads on which you put this design. And it's quite a complex three-dimensional geometry exercise, which the weaver is doing. But he's doing it using the graph paper. So it speeds it up a little. So if you look at both computer and loom in tandem rather than in opposition, that the computer is very fast, the loom is very slow. What I found is in making the design that previously the master used to make it alone, it was being done by the computer weaver and the programmer together, it had speeded up. Making the graph for the design, again the computer programmer did it, it speeded up. Making the setup for the loom, master weaver used the computer printout, it speeded up. Visualization, layout, wages, price used to be done on the loom after weaving, then you would calculate. Now it could be done previously. That also speeded up. In weaving, the weaver used to do jamdani, even after the weaver would have the jamdani, the process slowed down. And changing to next design also speeded up. So what happened is you speeded up everything else so that the weaver could slow down. So in total, the entire system didn't slow down too much. And they were actually able to use this very labor intensive technology without increasing labor cost too much. And that is how the computer actually used the. So it was possible to look at them in tandem rather than looking at them in opposition. Now, if there is really so much innovation in hand, why is it that it's not visible? Why is it that it's not seen? And that was a question that I looked at, and what I found is because there is so much positive value to continue to saying that this was something that has been there from before. And even for instance, the women who buy it, they want to have a recall of the tradition. There is such a positive value to continue that actually what happens is that after they do something innovative, the weavers, they recast it as tradition. For instance, the upada, that is so-called traditional upada jamdani sari, which the images of which I showed you, there was no such thing, or at least the traditional upada jamdani sari is very different from this sari. But the person who introduced it into upada, this Ghanshyam Sarode, created an entire past for them. So you get the promotional literature talks about how the Mobili queen wore it and how this, and you know, so you have this Vijayanagar princess used to wear upada saris. But actually this sari and that sari were, I mean, totally recreated tradition. So you innovate and then you call it tradition. And that is how you actually move forward, because you have this huge positive value. And the advantage of this is that you're always able to draw on your existing knowledge base. But it actually didn't stop with positive value for continuing. There was a huge negative value for innovation in traditional crafts. And this I encountered in the music world. So this totally by chance I was there, and this very famous musician was performing. And performing in the middle of a huge controversy where one of the younger musicians had been changing the format of the kacheri, and everybody had been complaining about how it was too radical and was not classical and it was not part of our culture. But this woman went and performed exactly what he did. But after doing that, she said, "Don't think this is innovation, this is tradition. This is what my guru used to do." And I was very excited because I said, "See, this person is doing exactly what my leader is doing." And you know, so I got very excited and told her, "See, you're also innovative." And she threw me out of the house. She said, "Why do I need innovation? And what is this innovation? It is such an immodest claim to say that I have innovated. This has come to me from my guru. It has come by the grace of God. And it is given to me by the good fortune of my previous births. And you cannot suddenly come and tell me I am being innovative. This is not done." And in a sense, I recall that sentiment that is felt generally, that to call yourself innovative and to be innovative is seen as being individualistic and immoral. So it recurs. It's a recurring theme in our way of even the designers. And the question then is that asks, do you really need, does a classic need to be innovative? It's a classic, it's there. Do we really need to innovate? So actually, at that point is where I made the shift to talking about it in terms of creative response of creativity. And I was able to then, I interviewed a lot of musicians to see how they innovated, what kind of vocabulary they used. I asked them, what is the creative process, how does it happen? They're very clear. There is sadhana, where you do endless repetition, and there is manodharma, where you are being creative. And these are very, very distinct practices. And this is the vocabulary that they use. So what is the sadhana? The sadhana is the work that comes before you are creative. And what is it that you have to do? The first step. And I spoke to some 15 musicians. They all gave me these steps. And I'm sure any of you who know any music will recognize, or any art will recognize these steps. First, you have to build skill through repetition. Repeat the same thing over and over and over till you build some skill. Then you have to learn the rules of the ragam, of the song, through imitation. It cannot be learned by a book. Somebody has to sing, you have to listen, you have to imitate, you have to learn. Then within that, you have to start varying it. And as you vary, you generate fluency. Then, during the performance, there is an uncertainty. There is a not knowing what is going to happen. And you have to sit there and you have to produce something new. Now, this senior musician talked about it as divine bliss of creative. That is her vocabulary. And she says it requires leap of faith, because you don't know before you produce it creatively whether it's going to happen or not. And she stressed the importance of the guru. And in that moment of creativity, when you are actually producing that something very beautifully, they experience an absence of self. Which is why, in her belief system, she could say it is God. But she experienced it as a total absence of self. And this is how she explained what happens in sadhana and what happens in manodharma. Now I took this back to science. And literature says exactly the same thing. 10 years of practice in creative development. If you produce your first paper when you're 25, your most innovative work you will produce when you're 35. You practice that craft for 10 years. In form of heuristics, in a laboratory, if you want to learn how to do an experiment, you have to figure out how people are doing. Follow those rules. So that is the second step. You have to learn fluency and flexibility. And finally, and this is where the creative moment usually happens as a challenge. You face a problem where what you've already acquired as knowledge or your skills are not enough to face the challenge that is in front of you. And then you have to make that leap. And then actually you, so the creativity in a sense, innovation, they say, or invention is the, or necessity is the mother of invention, like that. So the problem happens, and at that point, you actually, so in fact, one way of testing creativity is to challenge with problems on it. And even within science, you talk about the Eureka moment of pain. So you talk about the leap of insight that has to happen, and the importance of the teacher. And exactly as an art, you experience the moment of creativity as a totally unconscious. Now if, so in a sense the mirroring, both in this and that. So the question is that if really there are such differences in tradition and innovation, then why is it that we see them as being so apart? Because in both, first you build craft through practice, and in both innovation is accompanied by a leap of faith or an unconscious process. And here, the point I want to make is that when you acquire craft through practicing, the words that you have, like practice, imitation, repetition, these are not seen as being very creative things. And in fact, imitation is seen as a low form of creativity. Invariably, these are steps that you go through to before you reach the level.
Actually, in the vocabulary of technological innovation, also these steps are
coming. These steps are coming.
It's exactly the same steps.
Exactly.
When you basically dismantle something and ask why.
Right.
Okay, put it back.
Correct.
Learn the rules.
Yeah.
Then you start doing rudimentary design.
Yes.
Okay, that is you're learning the rule.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then you start variation.
Yes.
You add a feature.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And take out a feature.
Right.
Like that.
Yeah.
You slightly increase the efficiency.
Yeah.
Things like that you do.
Yeah.
And then ultimately you actually make a new product.
Absolutely. Right.
So it's the same. It is the same.
So here the limited thing seems to be that you have the rigorous practice, the craft acquiring that issue, both in science, in music and in handloom, and you also have the unconscious creative process that happens, both happen. And it is important to see that all these things which can be written off as drudgery, as labor, actually are not, seem to be a very critical part of building that skill and now it's not to say that everybody who has skill is innovative, but definitely if you want innovation, you have to have some amount of repetition, imitation having happened. So whether
it's that as in the great moment suddenly arrives.
Yes, you have to have. But in science, we focus on the rational method, on the rules, on the repetitive rule following, rigorous discipline, while on the rational process. And in music, definitely there is a focus more on the experience of creativity, of faith. So we stress on one part of it for science and we stress on the other part of it for science, but they are actually complementary. So, so basically what at the end of it I found is that while one can find it difficult to talk about innovation, as you say, the direction of innovation, the concept itself seems difficult, alien in our kind of collaborative context. But when we talk about creativity and we talk about doing something new, it seems that the vocabularies merge quite and the methodologies merge quite. And for me, this is an important step because while one can make a case for handloom as technology, as knowledge, as science, I was looking for a way to make a case for handloom as craft, which is what it also is predominantly. And it is that craft, the importance of craft, the relevance of craft for a society that we are discussing. And in fact, when I went back with this to my supervisor, he said it's absolutely true in Netherlands because their biggest industry is based on the thing that they have crafting, which is the selection of seeds, and that's done as a craft even today. So there can really be no innovation without craft. So these are the two questions. Are innovation and innovation really possible?